At the age of 9, he knew what he wanted to do with his life, and he never wavered from that goal. Now he's one of the world's most famous scientists. He's earned the title of most powerful nerd in the universe from National Public Radio, and the title of the world's sexiest astrophysicist from People magazine. He was also instrumental in cutting down the number of planets in our solar system, and in doing so, he upset an entire generation who had come to love Pluto as the small, quirky planet. And, well, who is this icon of science that's recognizable by the general populace? Well, of course, it's Neil deGrasse Tyson. Tyson was born in New York City in 1959, and he grew up in the Bronx. His mother worked for the U.S. Department of Health, Education, and Welfare, and his father worked for the City of New York. Tyson, he was a star student at the Bronx High School of Science. Well, before beginning at the Bronx High School of Science, though, Tyson had decided that science was the path that he wanted to follow with his life. When he was in elementary school, Tyson's class took a field trip to the Hayden Planetarium. While there, he felt that he was literally called to a career in science. "So strong was that imprint of the night sky that I'm certain that I had no choice in the matter, that in fact, the universe called me." Tyson immediately began committing time to his newfound interest, and some might say obsession, and his time in high school showed his dedication to the study of the stars. While attending the Bronx High School of Science, Tyson was a wrestler, but he devoted much time to his studies. He was the editor of the Physical Science Journal, and regular classes, they weren't enough for him. He actually took classes at the very place that sparked his interest in astrophysics, the Hayden Planetarium. After school, he spent time observing the sky, the moon, the stars, all from the roof of his home in New York. His dedication to science and academics during his teenage years grabbed the attention of some very prominent people. One of these, well, you might have heard of him. That's Carl Sagan. When it came time for Tyson to apply to college, Cornell was among the schools that he applied to. Sagan was a professor at Cornell, and the admissions office made sure he was sent a copy of Tyson's application after they saw the talent and potential that was within this aspiring scientist. Sagan was duly impressed by what Tyson had written in his application, so much so that he invited Tyson to spend a day at Cornell. Tyson, he remembers that day in 1975 as one of the most formative days of his life. Sagan, well, he died in 1996, and Tyson came into possession of his datebook, which includes the notation Neil Tyson on the square for December the 20th, 1975. The two science-minded men spent the day together, touring Cornell's labs and discussing the mysteries of the universe. Sagan gifted Tyson with a copy of the book, The Cosmic Connection, inscribing it to indicate his prediction and hope for Tyson's career to a future astronomer. Tyson never forgot what he learned from Sagan that day, and the lessons he took back to the Bronx with him were more than just the scientific method. "I already knew I wanted to become a scientist, but that afternoon I learned from Carl the kind of person I wanted to become. He reached out to me and to countless others, inspiring so many of us to study, teach, and do science. Science is a cooperative enterprise, spanning the generations." A few months after his visit to Cornell, Tyson graduated from the Bronx High School of Science. Even though his visit with Sagan had a profound impact on his life, Tyson opted not to attend Cornell. But as an excellent student, he had no shortage of prominent schools to choose from. Though Cornell wasn't the right fit for him, Harvard was. Tyson entered Harvard as an undergraduate in the fall of 1976. As a student, he paid his tuition partially through grants and scholarships, but also through a work-study program. Part of Tyson's work requirement was to clean bathrooms on campus, including those of the other students. On a Larry King Live appearance, he described the experience as a little weird, but he was willing to do it to pay his way through school and to achieve his dreams. Working and studying physics weren't enough to occupy the active and curious Tyson, though. He was on the crew team and the wrestling team while he was at Harvard, and he was also a jazz, ballet, and Latin dancer. He graduated from Harvard in 1980 with a degree in physics and kept his academic career moving forward with an acceptance to the University of Texas for a master's program. He completed his MA in astronomy in 1983, and he intended to pursue a doctorate from the college. But, well, he hit a roadblock, and Tyson himself admits that the roadblock was largely of his own making. Looking back, he has admitted that he didn't devote as much time to doing lab research during his graduate years as he should have and could have, and this prevented him from being able to go right from his master's program to earning a doctoral degree. He even had professors tell him to stop working in the field of astronomy. At one point, struggling as a student and broke, Tyson considered a very different job than that of a professor or museum director. He thought about becoming an exotic dancer. He even went so far as to go to a show to see if he could do it. When the dancers came out and their skimpy undergarments were lit up as they gyrated to a rendition of Great Balls of Fire, Tyson decided that no matter how broke he was, exotic dancing, well, it wasn't for him. Thankfully for the scientific community, though, Tyson's break from academics, it was short-lived. With his undergraduate achievements and a start on a graduate degree, he was able to land a teaching job at the University of Maryland, and eventually he found his way back onto the doctoral track in the Ivy League. In 1991, 15 years after scrubbing toilets to pay for his undergraduate degree, Tyson graduated from Columbia University with a doctorate in astrophysics. He then studied in the Ivy League system, moving to Princeton for a postdoctoral position. While he was earning his degrees and moving his way up the academic ladder, Tyson was publishing articles and writing a column for Stardate, a science magazine published by the University of Texas. While he was attending Columbia, he also worked under a professor who was supportive of Tyson's ambitions and intellect, applying for grants that gave Tyson access to the international astronomy community. Tyson, he traveled throughout Europe attending meetings and learning from the best and brightest in the field from all around the world. And Tyson's own star, it was also beginning to rise. Soon after graduating from Columbia, well, he landed his dream job. And yep, that was a position back at the Hayden Planetarium, where his dreams had started. He started out as a staff scientist, but it was after 1 year that he was named acting director of the planetarium. Then, only one more year later, he was formally named the director of the Hayden Planetarium. Early on in his tenure in director, he made updating and modernizing the facility a keystone of his work at Hayden. The project, it was a $200 million undertaking that gave the public a modernized, inviting look into the vastness of the universe. And his work, well, that extended way beyond the planetarium. In 2001, he received a presidential appointment to work on policies related to the future of the US space industry. After that, he was part of a commission to work on the future of space exploration. His service on these committees was so impressive that NASA gave him the Distinguished Public Service Medal. Tyson's scientific work, as well as decisions he made about the Hayden Planetarium, put him in the spotlight for the general public, well beyond those normally in the scientific community. He actually became a household name because of one particular decision. And what did he do? Well, he removed the planet of Pluto from the planetarium's solar system display. School children, parents, and scientists alike were not impressed with his decision. And soon, it became more about just the planetarium's display. Pluto's fate, it was taken up by an international organization, the International Astronomical Union. In 2006, the organization made their stance on Pluto official when they deemed Pluto a dwarf planet, officially knocking our solar system down to having only 8 planets. So, well, the question might be now, well, what does Tyson maintain is so wrong with Pluto? Well, for one, it has the potential to grow a tail. Yes, that is a legitimate reason, and here is the man himself explaining it. So, Pluto is not the littlest planet, alright? That alone shouldn't hurt it. But more than half of its volume is ice. No other planet has that. So, if you moved it to where Earth is right now, heat from the sun would evaporate the ice and it would grow a tail. That's no kind of behavior for a planet. Add to that, Pluto's orbit is much more elongated than that of the other planets, and it's so small that the other planets have moons that are larger than Pluto, and you're beginning to see why he falls on the Pluto is not a planet side of the fence. Now, the Pluto thing was one of the most famous, maybe infamous, scientific assertions of Tyson's career. Indeed, he has written articles, essays, and even books that discuss in much more detail the demotion of this planet. How this worked was he wrote for National History magazine in the 1990s, and his columns were later turned into two different books. These were Death by Black Hole and Astrophysics for People in a Hurry. He chose the pen name of Merlin for himself when he wrote a column in the Stardate magazine, and those columns, they were also later published as books. Tyson hasn't just used publications to spread the word about science and the universe. He's hosted TV shows, he regularly appears as a guest on other shows, and he has his own podcast called Star Talk. He hosted Nova Science Now in the mid-2000s, raising his profile even further to most Americans. He was so popular as a host that in 2014, the network brought him back to delve even further into science for the American people. The 2014 show gave Tyson an opportunity to build on the work of a man who had impacted him early on. And that would be Carl Sagan. Well, that show was Cosmos, a new version of the popular one that Sagan had hosted in the 1980s. At the time of its airing, Cosmos was the most watched show in the United States. But if there was anyone who could live up to these kind of expectations, well, that would be Tyson. He didn't have to go it alone in 2014, though. He had the help of Sagan's widow, who worked as a writer for Cosmos, and the two made sure to include allusions to Sagan's work throughout the rebooted series. The series, it was a success, and over 3 million Americans put their TV onto Fox to catch the newest science lesson presented by Tyson every Sunday for 13 weeks. The Cosmos reboot was undoubtedly successful and showed Tyson's appeal to the general populace. But his appeal in the media, well, it goes well beyond direct and serious science. He's appeared as a guest on Family Guy, Brooklyn Nine-Nine, and as character in New Ice Age. The Big Bang Theory, with its nerdy cast, has of course welcomed Tyson as a guest. He even made an appearance on Avenged Sevenfold's album, The Stage. He didn't sing, but instead delivered a monologue during one of the band's songs. A musical appearance that was rumored to happen that never actually came about was that Tyson would appear on an album with Wu-Tang Clan member GZA. Though the appearance never happened, it does speak to Tyson's breadth of talents and popularity that many people thought it was a very probable thing for Tyson to do. While the album didn't happen, Tyson and GZA did appear together when GZA rapped on Star Talk. Even The Daily Show has regularly featured Tyson to comment on science matters, and as he did with Pluto, Tyson makes no bones about sharing his thoughts on what needs to be corrected. Indeed, Live On Air informed Jon Stewart, "The beginning of your program, the Earth is spinning the wrong direction. I'm sorry, I had to get that off my chest." The Earth on the credits was spinning clockwise when Earth really spins counterclockwise. Though Tyson pointed it out to Stewart and the entire viewing audience, it wasn't until Trevor Noah took over as host in 2015 that the show made a permanent correction to the Earth's spinning direction. Tyson was excited about the change and tweeted out his thanks to The Daily Show. The Daily Show's Globe isn't the only correction that Tyson's scientific knowledge has led to in the realm of pop culture. Well, you might remember that 1997 blockbuster movie, Titanic. Well, Tyson saw it and he wasn't impressed. Near the end, after the ship has sunk, Rose is lying on a board in the freezing Atlantic Ocean. She's gazing up at the night sky, and the audience can see what she sees, the stars in the sky over the ocean. When Tyson saw that scene, he noticed something that the rest of us didn't. Well, the stars, they weren't in the right arrangement for the year 1912 at the latitude and longitude where the Titanic sunk. So, as with The Daily Show, Tyson let director David Cameron know. According to Cameron, Tyson sent him a snarky email on the subject. 15 years after that film was first released, Cameron took Tyson's suggestion and adjusted the night sky in that scene in order to be accurate. Titanic and The Daily Show weren't enough for Tyson. He's even had a hand in keeping Superman scientifically accurate. DC Comics wanted to feature the world's most famous astrophysicist in a comic, but Tyson wouldn't do it unless he could be sure of the accuracy. With the distance Krypton is supposed to be from Earth, Tyson said he would never be able to help Superman spot it. So, well, what did he do? Well, he did his research and found an actual red star to serve as Krypton, and crafted a story whereby Superman would combine all the telescopes on Earth to be able to see Krypton. So no media format has been untouched by Tyson. The man is everywhere spreading the word of science, and the people of the world, well, we're listening. Creators and producers take his advice and seek him out for appearances. Among scientists, he is unique in this kind of stardom. A serious scientist and pop culture figure would seem to make any person interesting enough, but Tyson has hobbies and interests that go well beyond the mysteries of space and the sharing of science. He and his wife Alice, who he met in a physics class, are both foodies. Tyson has said they probably spend too much money on food, but living in Manhattan, they have so many restaurants to explore and so many food options to try out that they take every opportunity they can to try new foods. Tyson, he's also a wine connoisseur. His love of science plays a big role in his enjoyment of wine, helping him to understand understand why different wine tastes different and how they best can be served. Like much else, Tyson explains these concepts simply so that non-scientists can understand them too. The lower than 32 degrees freezing point of liquids that contain alcohol, like wine, allows you to chill a bottle of white wine to sub-freezing temperatures without it freezing before you bring it to a dinner party. The wine warms up during the travel time to just the right temperature in time for dinner. Indeed, a rather well-known scientist is the source of Tyson's favorite quote about food and wine, and that would be Galileo. "The sun, with all those planets revolving around it and dependent on it, can still ripen a bunch of grapes as if it had nothing else in the universe to do." Food, wine, physics, well, what's left for him to care about and learn about? Well, calligraphy, for one. Tyson can create beautiful lettered art with a feathered pen, but is especially passionate about fountain pens. He loves them so much that his wife spent $6,000 to buy him a Japanese-made pen as a gift when he finalized the contract on his autobiography. He even gave an entire interview to the New York Times on the pen and his love of calligraphy. In the interview, he described his own mathematical theory behind how you can tell if a pen is perfect for calligraphy. "Having to dip the pen in ink after every 8 to 10 words means you're writing with a beautiful rhythm," he says. He's passionate about life and everything in it. He's passionate about science, and the world knows it. With all that he's accomplished in his life and the celebrity status he's achieved, it would be easy to excuse Tyson for having a large ego. But he doesn't. In fact, he takes special pains to point out the danger of ego. If your ego starts out, "I am important, I am big, I am special," you're in for some disappointments when you look around at what we've discovered about the universe. No, you're not big. No, you're not. You're small in time and space. And you have this frail vessel called the human body that's limited on Earth. Perhaps this attitude is a large part of his success and why he is so beloved. For all his intelligence and his contributions to the study of space, Neil deGrasse Tyson remains firmly planted with 2 feet, right here on Earth. So I really hope you enjoyed the video. If you did, please do hit that thumbs up button below, and don't forget to subscribe for brand new videos every Monday and Thursday. And if you've got a suggestion for us, would you like to see us make a biographics video about someone in particular? Well, please do join in the comment section below and let us know what you thought of this video as well. We're always looking to improve and make these videos better, and we can only do that with your help and feedback. So please do get involved in the comments. And as always, thank you for watching.